असतो मा सत्कमया तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमया मृत्योर्मा अमृतं गमया आविरावीर्महेधि रुद्रयत्ते दक्षिणं मुखं तेन मां पाहि नित्यम्। मे द डिवाइन लीड अस फ्रॉम द अनरियल टू द रियल, फ्रॉम डार्कनेस टू लाइट, फ्रॉम डेथ टू इमोर्टैलिटी। May the divine consciousness fill our hearts and protect us. Peace, peace, peace be unto all. Friends, I'm very happy to be here. As you heard from the brief introduction, I had the privilege to be at the Mylapore Math for a period of 15 years, and during that time, I had a chance to meet with many of the students and faculty from IIT. Although I was not formally connected with the Vivekananda study circle, which started in 1997, just a year before I left Chennai. During my years here, almost 25 years ago, there's one interesting incident happened. I was obviously like, probably some of you were not born then, but I was much younger, and most of us were younger 25 years ago. So we had a batch of Japanese, about 40 or 50 people, were going to visit the mutt in Mylapore. And the Swamiji who was in charge of the mutt was going to address them. And the day they were supposed to come, our head Swamiji had to go to Calcutta for an urgent meeting. And so he asked me to fill in for him. And so these batch of about 40 Japanese people, they were tourists, but they were also interested in learning about Indian cultural and religious traditions. So they had come to the mutt, and I was asked to tell them a little bit about Vedanta, about the Hindu tradition. And as you may have guessed, there were about 40 people and at least 40 video cameras all facing me, and it was pretty intimidating. Anyway, I spoke with them for about 15 or 20 minutes, giving them a brief outline of the Vedantic principles. And then I opened it up for questions and answers. And what impressed me was one of them gets up. And there was an interpreter, so every sentence I was translating was being translated to Japanese and in the reverse also. So this one person gets up and then says that we are very practical people. He said that there is, because I in my talk I had spoken about oneness and attaining samadhi and all of that. So this person said, we are very practical people. And I don't see any hope of attaining samadhi in this life. So tell me something very practical, which I can practice right now. And which was, I found, a very thought-provoking thing, because oftentimes when we speak about religion and spirituality, there is a great temptation to indulge into abstractions. When you speak about philosophy, it's easier to speak about abstract things. But the challenge is, how do we translate, how do we transform these abstract principles into working, practicable techniques that we can follow in daily life? So those who take spiritual life seriously have to grapple with one important question, and that is, how important is intellectual understanding in practicing any form of spiritual life? How important is it to study books? How important is it to study scriptures in order to be spiritual? And there is no definitive answer to it, because we see within our tradition great acharyas, Shankara, Ramanuja, Madhva, great scholars, amazing commentaries they have written on these ancient books, and we found that those books and their insights have helped many people. But we also see so many great saints and mystics in our great spiritual and cultural heritage who were not educated, who were not literate, who were not scholars. And the most, among the most recent examples is Ramakrishna Paramahamsa himself, the teacher of Swami Vivekananda. He was unlettered, he wasn't a scholar in the sense we understand the word today. And that did not prevent him from attaining the heights of spiritual life. So, intellectual understanding doesn't seem to be an absolute necessity. And yet, as we begin to understand life, one thing that we all have to realize sooner or later is that learning never stops. Now, many of you, most of you I imagine here, are students here. And it would seem as if after you graduate, after you enter into the job market, so to speak, your studies will end. You'll stop being students and you'll be something else. Now, from a spiritual standpoint, we never stop being students. The Sanskrit word for a student, and also in many Indian languages, is vidyarthi. Vidya is knowledge. Arthi means the one who wants. So, vidyarthi literally means one who wants knowledge. Now, that gets translated into English as student. What we have to ask is, when we go to school, or when we go to a great place like this, what are we here for? Are we here for knowledge, or are we here to get a good degree, because that is essential in order to launch into a great career? If all that I'm seeking is a degree, then I'm probably a degree arthi, not so much a vidyarthi. So there is a difference. Now, I'm not suggesting that you shouldn't be thinking about scoring great grades and getting good marks and doing well in your exam. That's absolutely important. But alongside that, we have also to see how much knowledge I'm acquiring, how much hunger, how much thirst I have for knowledge. And that's why the title for today's talk is Four Simple Exercises. I call them simple because here is an attempt to make concrete what might seem to be a very abstract principles. And so I'm not trying to reduce the spiritual life into some kind of four simple things, but at least a way we can find ways of what I should do in order to be spiritual. Besides reading books, besides going to temples, besides doing all the worship, what is it that I can do in my present state? And in that spirit, therefore, I would like to share with you four principles, really five, but let's begin with four. Now, these four exercises can be subdivided into sets of two. So there are two plus two. First two are the two things that we need to forget in life if we want to be spiritual, if we want to be, forget about spiritual, if we want to be happy. Just a little bit of a detour. One of the categories that's so popular among the student communities the world over, and certainly in the West, is the category called spiritual but not religious. How many of you I would identify as spiritual but not religious? Okay, a fairly good number. But this is a very increasingly a great category in the Western student community. And partly this is a kind of a reaction because religion gets so often identified with religious organizations, and the kind of news that we read about religious organizations in the media hasn't exactly been very glorifying. We read about scandals, we read about financial irregularities, and so it's natural for people to kind of get disillusioned. We don't want to get into this religious stuff because it's not good. That's what many people feel. And so compared to the word religion, spirituality seems a much more neutral term. And so people feel more comfortable saying that they are spiritual rather than saying that they are religious, because the word religious has acquired a lot of different connotations. In any case, whichever way we see ourselves, one thing is certain, that if we want to be happy, if we want to be successful, if we want to experience contentment in life, we need to find ways of looking deeply into what all this means and what I should do. And in that spirit, therefore, again, to go back to those four exercises. So two things, first, two things to forget and two things to remember. Let me take them up one by one. So first thing to forget, if we want to be happy in life, is forget all the good that you have done to other people. Now, what it means is this: continue doing good, continue doing what you feel is right, but after having done what is right, what is good, continue doing your dharma, but after having done that, don't think about it. The reason is this: if you do something good to someone, if you help someone and you don't forget it, it sets up an expectation in your heart. It's a little bit like you invite your friend for a birthday party, and next, when that friend's birthday comes, that friend doesn't invite you. And if you still remember, you say, well, I invited him or her and she didn't invite me, then you don't feel good. So this is just a very simple example, but the idea is this: you should continue to do what is good but not remember it. So remembering all the good that we have done to other people often increases one's ego, or how good I am, how great I am, how charitable I am, how helpful I am. And the more egoistic we become, the less are the possibilities of us becoming truly happy. Just look at the people around you. Those who have a very egoistic, you'll find they suffer a lot more. But even from the perspective of karma, helping someone, we don't have to really take too much credit for it. According to the theory of karma, that we are merely carriers. It's like this: let's say you have ordered something from Amazon.com, let's say, and you order, and oftentimes it happens with many people, you order something and then you forget about it, and then after about 2 weeks or 3 weeks, the postman shows up with a packet. Now, you don't go about, even you might still say thank you to the postman if it's the custom, but you don't say, oh, postman, because of you I got it, you are so wonderful, because you know you are paid for it and you only got what you paid for, and the postman was merely carrying what was already yours. In the same way, when we do good to someone, when we help someone, the good that we do belongs to that person. It's the karma of that person that attracts that good. We are merely carriers. So if we see ourselves as merely carriers, then there is a less chance of being egoistic, less chance of setting up this chain of expectations in our heart. So that's the first thing. Do all the good you can, and then make an effort to not dwell on it too much. The second thing to forget might be a little bit more difficult than the first one, and that is, forget all the bad that others have done to you. Sometimes we see that we carry on our shoulders so much weight, so much about, oh, this person did that to me. All the biases, the prejudices, the hates that we carry in our heart rob us of the freedom, the spontaneity, the joy, the peace that we need in our daily life. And sometimes this can go for generations. It might so happen that your father did this to my father, so I'm going to not talk with you. So this can sometimes go for generations. So again, think about it this way: if someone hurts you, it's also possible to see that the hurt, the pain, the misery, the suffering that I have is something that came to me as a result of my own karma. The person who brought it to me was only a carrier. Again, going back to that postman's analogy, if a postman brings a letter to you which brings some bad news, you don't beat up the postman for that, because the postman is not responsible, the postman is only carrying it. So a person who believes in the theory of karma would say that whatever pain that I receive now is a pain that has come to me as a result of my karma, and the person who is delivering it to me is only a postman. Now, I say this because, again, a heart which is filled with hatred, or filled with anger, filled with any of these negative emotions can never be at peace, can never be happy. So this is the second thing to remember. Forget all the bad that people have done to you. The third exercise would be, third and fourth would be the two things that we need to remember. So the first two were about the two things we need to forget, and the next two would be the two things that we need to remember. So the first thing to remember is that everything is transient. Nothing lasts. Everything is temporary. When we are young, it's very difficult to think about the changes. But if we just think about it a little bit, reflect on it a little bit, we see that things are always changing. And for instance now, something that's very obvious is if you have lived in a city for some time and then you visit it after a few years, you already find there's a lot of change. Now for me, I have come to Chennai in the recent years, but when I think about the city as it was 25, 30, 40 years ago, and I'm sure many of the elders here would concur with that it looks much different. It's changed a lot. And so it's cities that change, it's people that change, everything. Nothing remains constant in life. So recognizing the reality of impermanence is very important for our own peace of mind. The Sanskrit word for the world is samsara. And in Sanskrit, samyak sarati, that which is constantly changing, that which is constantly moving. Now, awareness of change is very important because it helps us deal with the ups and downs in our lives in a more mature way. Because there is not a single person in the entire world who can say that I have never been miserable, I've never been happy. In our lives, we experience both joy as well as sorrow, sukha as well as dukkha, and they alternate. And none of them last forever. So if we are passing through a rough patch, if there's something terrible happening in our lives, the consolation is just wait a while. You'll find that after a while, it'll go away. So it'll help us deal with the difficult situations in life, knowing that that's not there forever. It'll also keep us grounded when things are going well in our life, because we know that even the highs in our life are not going to last forever. What this awareness of temporariness does in life is it helps us realize the value of people and value of things. It's like when you go to a garden and pluck a few roses and then arrange them well in a flower vase, let's say. And then they're there on your desk, on your table, and you look at those beautiful, fresh roses, and it makes your heart happy. You change water for 2 or 3 days and try to keep those flowers as fresh as much as possible. But you know that after 4 or 5 or 6 days, slowly the petals are going to wither, the flower is going to dry, and then it would be time to throw it away. Now, when the flower dries up and it's time to throw away, you don't cry, you don't weep, because even when you got those fresh flowers, you knew that they were not going to last forever. But because you knew that they were not going to last forever, you were able to enjoy them, and when it was time for them to go, you were in peace. But that's true not just with flowers. I remember just a few months ago, when I was in Boston, I'd gone to the post office to mail a package, and so one of the questions they asked there is, are there any perishable goods in it? And then I looked at the person and I said, everything is perishable in life. What is imperishable? And then, of course, the postman was in no mood, the post people, for a philosophical discussion. They just looked at me and said, you are very funny. but everything is perishable. So it's not just flowers. It's even people around us, members of our family, our friends. None of them are going to last forever. Just like every one of us. So neither we nor the people around us are going to last forever. That doesn't mean we have to start weeping and crying and grieving right now. But recognizing that none of us are going to be here forever, we value them. We understand them. We try to understand them. We try to make the best use of their presence in our lives. Oftentimes, one of the things that happens is that when you lose someone who is close to you, one of the things that often haunts many people is, oh, I should have asked this to the person. This is what I should have said. But sometimes it's too late. The person is gone. And so if we recognize that the temporary nature of everything in life, we will value the presence of the members of our family, our parents, our relatives, our friends, and then make best use of their presence in our lives. So recognizing the impermanence is very important. It might seem as if it's a very depressing thought, but actually it's not. The more you think about how temporary it is, the more free you become. Think about it this way. Our own existence, for instance. Now we know that we are not here forever, but the idea, the notion of death is a very unpleasant topic. Nobody wants to talk about it because we know we are going to die. What's there to talk about it? But think about it this way. We plan for so many things in life. Many of those things never happen the way we thought. There's one thing that's definitely going to happen in our life for which many of us don't have any plan. And the thing is, we are going to die. Now, we don't want to happen too soon. Sooner or later, it's going to happen. But we have no plan for it. So it makes sense, even from a very rational standpoint, to have some plan for something that is absolutely certain in life. Now, think about this in this way. Imagine, it's kind of a case study. Suppose, if you believe in God, and God goes and tells a person that you are going to live for another 7 days. That's it. You're going to die after 7 days. Now, what would be the state of mind of that person? Now, since God herself has said that you're going to die, there's nothing you could need to do. You can't go anywhere. If God says you're going to die, you're going to die. So it's understandable that for a day at least, this person might be a little bit morose, knowing that, well, after a week, I've got to go. But then once you know that something is inevitable, what do you do of the second day, third day? Then we see that the way we begin to look at the world changes. I mean, it would change right now. Many of you are going to graduate this year, let's say, after your exams. The way you look at this environment is going to be very different from the way you looked at it when you came here as new students. Because you know, within a few days, I have to leave this campus. So our perception changes when we know that it's time to go. Exactly in the same way, in this hypothetical person who knows that he is going to die after 7 days, his way of looking at himself, looking at the world around, will change. Think about it. Will this person want to go and fight with anyone during those last 3, 4, or 5 days remaining? What's the point? You're just going to leave everything anyway. If I cherish, say, this is a very precious glass that I love, and a friend comes and says, would you please give that glass to me? I'm not going to say, no, I'm going to hold on to it. I'm not going to say that because I know whether I like it or not, within 4 or 5 days, it's good. I have to leave it behind. I have no choice. So all the clinging to things, all the biases, the prejudices, the anger, the hatred, everything will go away because everything will appear so pointless, so meaningless. because the perspective will change. In fact, the last 4 or 5 days of this person's life would be the happiest, the best days of that person's life. Because you're truly freed yourself from all attachments, all clinging. You will experience freedom even before you die because you are able to see things differently, recognizing the one truth which is true in the case of all of us. Now, this person is actually very lucky because God told that person, you're going to die after a week. The person was absolutely certain, I'm not going to die before that week is over. None of us is so lucky. We don't know. We could die after a day, after a week, after a year, maybe after 50 years. We don't know. And that's the problem. We don't know when we are going to die. It's not as if only old people die. Young people die too. Probably young people die. Young ones die more than older do. So we can't simply attribute death to age. We can't simply attribute it to health. Because apparently healthy people die as well. So there is no objective category by which we can determine the person is going to die, because any of us can die anytime. And that's important. I remember years ago when I was studying in high school, in our Hindi class, we had a lesson, and this was way back in the 60s. So that lesson was titled Marna Ek Kala Ek Chance. And it was such a thoughtful lesson that I remember some of the things exactly in the exact words that were there in it. So one of the things that was said in that was, क्या तुम्हें यही यह नहीं लगता है कि वह आदमी अधिक बुद्धिमान है जो आसमान से तारे तोड़ने का प्रोग्राम बनाने के बजाय पेड़ से आम तोड़ने का प्रोग्राम बनाए? That this is what practicality is, that instead of planning to pluck stars from heavens, do I have any plan to pluck mangoes from a tree? And death, dealing with impermanence, is something that is so absolutely important and so something that is so directly connected with our own lives. And therefore, one of the incidents in Vivekananda's life is like this, that a group of college students came and met Swami Vivekananda after they returned from the West. And when they were around him, Swamiji asked them this question. He said, what is the most wonderful thing in the world? And the students were smart enough to not even attempt to answer that question. So they just remained quiet. And then Swamiji himself answered that question saying, we will all die one day. Now what's so wonderful about it? The wonderful about it is, first of all, that although we'll die, as I said, we never think about it. And Swamiji then told these youngsters, he said, always keep the thought of death before your mind's eye. And then one of the students said, Swamiji, wouldn't thinking about death make us morose, make us depressed? And Swamiji said, oh yeah, sure, it'll make you feel sad and morose for a while, but hold on to that thought. The problem is this, it's not as if we never think about death. Certainly, as I said, when someone close or near a dear one dies, we do think about death. You read about, there's plenty now, when you reopen the papers or look up the web, there's so much happening the world over. There are people dying, there's terrorism, there is all kinds of things. And so when you think about this, sometimes, but more especially, if someone close to us dies, the thought does come about death. But then we have this rationale, oh, I can't be mourning all the time, life has to go on, and then there's some kind of an auto mechanism that we move on with life and then forget about it until someone else dies and we think about it again. But Swami Vivekananda was recommending this, that hold on to that idea of death, even if it makes you depressed for a while. But slowly, when you are able to be comfortable with the thought that one day death will come, you will be free. You will be free from the fear of death. There is another one incident in Vivekananda's life. He was in Benares, in Kashi, as a young monk, and he was walking along this one Durga temple in Kashi, and there was a narrow lane in front of it, and Swamiji was going along it. And suddenly, he found a big number of monkeys, some 25, 30 monkeys chasing him. Not the tiny skinny monkeys you have outside here, which I saw just before coming in. They're really, really big ones. And they started chasing. And then Swamiji, you know, what are you going to do if you have 25 monkeys are following you? Then Swamiji started running. The more he ran, the more those monkeys chased him. Until from the other side, there was a very elderly sadhu coming. And then he saw this young sadhu running and those monkeys chasing him. And that sadhu stopped and looked at Swamiji and said, "Stop." And Swamiji stopped. And then that sadhu said, "Face the brutes." And he said with such power, such conviction, that Swamiji said, he just turned and looked at these monkeys in the eye. The monkeys also stopped. And as soon as their eyes were locked, the monkeys quietly went away. And Swamiji never forgot that lesson. Years later, when he was speaking in New York, he actually mentions this incident. And then he said that there are things in life we run away from. There are facts, there are truths, there are memories we don't want to deal with. But the more we try to run away from them, the more we try to escape them, the more they chase us. But at some point in life, we need to be strong enough to pause and look at whatever it is in life that we are afraid of, to just look at it in the eye. And if we can do that, face the brute, that was the word that was used. If we can do that, we'll feel tremendous amount of freedom. And that is what this thinking about death. Now, I'm not speaking about being obsessive about death. I mean, there's a very unhealthy way of thinking of death. That's not what I'm recommending. But there is a very positive way of thinking about death. And if we can do, you see, it's a little bit like this. Many of us are so much conditioned by some of the influences that we have acquired in childhood that it's very difficult to get rid of them. It's easier to learn things. It's difficult to unlearn some of the things that have become a part of our psyche, a part of our thinking. And death is a little bit like that. Because from very young age, we try to shelter young children about death. We don't try to give them an idea about it. And we grow with this kind of an unexamined fear of death. But at some stage in life, as adults, as at least young adults, we can pause and say, what is life? When I grow out of my childhood and become a teenager, really the child is dead. A teenager is born. But I'm not afraid of passing from childhood to teenage years. But no one remains a teenager forever. Then you enter youth. Then you enter middle age, old age. So just as these are stages of life, and death is also one stage of life, there is no reason why that should be given so much prominence. In any case, thinking about death is recognizing the presence of impermanence. So that's the first thing to remember, that everything is transient, everything is moving, everything goes away. The second thing to remember is that in the midst of all this change, in the midst of all this impermanence, there is one being, one truth that is permanent, that is unchanging. And you can call that truth by any name. A most common name used in religious and spiritual literature is God. So everything else changes, everything else moves, everything ends, God alone remains. In Vedanta literature, there's a simple equation, and that is satya equals nitya. If something is true, it is necessarily eternal. So if God is real, God has to be eternal. If there is an unchanging reality behind this universe. All of us should feel free to think about that reality in any way that comes naturally to us. But to recognize, we would not even notice movement unless there is something which is not moving behind it. And so that non-moving, unchanging reality behind the universe is generally called by the term God. And if we can find a way to identify ourselves with that reality or connect ourselves with that reality in some way, we will feel more stable. It's a little bit like you had this big, big storm and cyclone some time back. There's these huge winds going And if you just find yourself on a street, you're just going to get blown away by these winds. But if there is something stable you can hold on to, something which will never be shaken by that wind, by that storm, then you are safe. So similarly, these winds of life, the challenges, the difficulties are enormous. We need something which is unmoving, something which will help us keep our stability. And that something is the spiritual ideal. That something or someone is God. And that is something that we need to try to figure out in our life. So, four things. I said two things to forget and two things to remember. The two things to forget are, do all the good you can, but don't try to hold on to it. They say, in the Bhagavata, there is a statement which says, Ashahi paramam dukkham, nairashyam paramam sukham. Expectation brings the profoundest misery. Living with non-expectation brings us the greatest joy. What is often not recognized is that expecting something is a totally useless activity. Because it's like this. If you want to achieve something, if you want a certain outcome, you determine what action you need to take, what are the means to an end, and go ahead and do it. Then the end will come. But after doing what needs to be done, if I become anxious about it, if I'm expecting something, then actually the outcome doesn't change, because what is going to happen, it's going to happen. They say there is a book called Panchadashi. Years ago, here in Mailapur Math, when we were studying that text under a very renowned Pandit, there is one verse which comes in that text. This is how it goes in Sanskrit. Yat abhavi natat bhavi, bhavi chet natat anyatha, iti chinta vishagnoyam bodho brahmanivartakaha. What it simply means is this. Yat abhavi natat bhavi, that which is not going to happen will not happen. Bhavi chet, if something is going to happen, natat anyatha, it will definitely happen. So the first line says, that which is going to happen will happen, that which will not happen will not happen. Iti chinta vishad noyam bodho. Chinta vishad. Visha is poison. Chinta is anxiety. So the second line says, wise people free themselves from this poison of anxiety and become free from delusion when they recognize that that which will happen will happen, that which will not happen will not happen. How much of the joy, the spontaneity in our life, we just drained away by anxiety. And students are very familiar with it. Not just here, everywhere, all over the world. I get plenty of opportunity to interact with students in different parts, and certainly in Boston. And I find that a major, major cause of that prevents them from that just joyful living is this anxiety. And a simple way to get rid of the anxiety would be to, before I go there, here's one thing. The difference between anxiety and fear, the two are not exactly synonymous. Now, fear has a definite object. For instance, I can say, I'm afraid of snakes. I have a fear of snakes. So I know that my fear has an object, and I then know what to do. Because if I have fear of snakes, I need to keep away from snakes. I know there is something I can do about it. But if I'm anxious, if there is simply anxiety, anxiety has no object. And that's why it's very difficult to get rid of, because it's very hazy. You just feel a sense of anxiety. People speak about anxiety attacks, but you don't know what to do about it. So sometimes psychologists say that if you have anxiety, transform your anxiety into fear. Then at least you will know what is it that you are afraid of, and then you can at least think and do something about it. But going back to that expectation, if we can determine what we want to do in life, and determine what is it that I need to do now to achieve that goal, all that I need to do is just do it. And after having done your best, after having given your best shot at anything, then you step back and say, what will happen will happen. What will not happen will not happen. It really frees us up so much. So even as you study for your exams, or you're applying for your job for an interview, give your best shot. Use all the knowledge you have, get all the help you can, and try your best. Because at any given moment, we cannot do better than our best. You can only do your best. After having done your best, what can you do? Things will happen. Things will take their own course. Even if things don't succeed the way you thought they should, you at least have the satisfaction, I tried my best. But if you don't try your best, and then if you fail, there's always that feeling of guilt, I could have tried harder. I could have not wasted the time that I did. And so this verse would make complete sense if we are sincere in the goal that we have in our life, we try our best, and then we can step back and say, let things take their own course. So that's the thing about remembering impermanence. Remembering, forgetting the good that we do, because if I've done something good and if I deserve something in return, it'll come to me, whether I like it or not. It's like there's, suppose there's a cricket match, say between India and whatever other country. Naturally, as Indians, we would be rooting for our team. We would want our team to win. We would expect our team to win. But think about it this way. Whichever team plays well that day is going to win. You are expecting it or not expecting it is not going to change the outcome. So you are expecting your team to win really is a totally useless activity. What you can do is at least you can cheer them and try to encourage them. Well, that's doing something. But merely expecting really doesn't help. So anyway, I don't want to kind of beat this dog to death by just saying expecting is bad. But if you look at our life, we will see that if we can really touch our heart today and say, I don't expect anything from anyone, that I recognize that what I deserve will come to me. If I truly believe that there is such a thing as justice in life, even though sometimes in short term, life might seem to be unfair to many of us, but in longer term, taking a longer view, which is why the motto that our country adopted after independence was Satyam Eva Jayate. Ultimately, truth alone will triumph. There will be such a thing as justice. Then, we don't need to expect anything. We can say, I'm going to do what is right, I'm going to do what is good, and whatever I deserve, life will bring it to me. Don't expect anything from anyone. Not even gratitude. Think about it this way. Sometimes when you help your friend, you probably are not expecting any material benefit from it. But the very least, you would want that person to be grateful. Again, why are we so beggarly to even just wait for someone's thank you? Again, that we are demeaning ourselves by expecting any kind of return. Just the joy of giving, the joy of helping, the joy of doing what is right, the joy of doing what is good, that's enough of a reward. So, to conclude, four simple exercises. Two things to forget, two things to remember. Forget all the good that you have done to others. Forget all the bad that others have done to you. Two things to remember. Remember that everything is temporary. Everything is transient. And the second thing to remember, in the midst of everything that is changing, there is one truth, one reality, which is unchanging. And if I can hold on to that one truth, one reality, or God, my life can be truly happy, peaceful, and joyful. Now, I'm not reducing the entire spiritual life to these four things. That would be too simplistic. But at least, this is something that we can, if it makes sense, this is not some kind of a magic formula that I'm giving. But if what I have said up to this point makes sense, then this is something all of us can begin practicing right now. It's not some, you don't need to read big books for it, you don't need to attend retreats, you don't need to read scriptures, you don't need to do anything. This is something we can, because this is just a changing the way we think. sometimes changing our changing other things in life, changing your food habits, changing your dress style might be a little bit easier. But changing the way we think is a little bit tough. But if we recognize that there is a way in life we can be more happy than we are now, if there is a way in life we can experience greater peace than we are experiencing now, then we should be strong enough, we should have that courage, we should have that confidence to say, whatever changes are needed in order to make myself truly happy, truly successful, I shall do it. What Vivekananda taught was this, that every one of us has this enormous strength, enormous power to bring about whatever change is necessary. We don't have to depend on anything or anyone. Everything is within us. But if there is that firm determination, that sincerity, that perseverance, we all can do it. So I would encourage you all that if these four things make sense, then please try to see. Practice it even for a month. Try it only for a month as a trial. And if you feel like, oh, it doesn't work, it's just useless, then you can give it up. But try it and you will see that life would suddenly become a little bit more meaningful. You will find that not only will your relationships improve, but also that whatever things that you need to focus on, whether it's your studies or whatever other things that you're doing, you'll find it'll become much more easy. Work efficiency will increase. So give it a try. And alongside, read Swami Vivekananda's books. Read any books that bring you positive insights in life. And I mentioned Swami Vivekananda because as a student myself, my introduction to spiritual life occurred through Swami Vivekananda's books. And therefore, I can never stop recommending it to others, because something that, you know, it's like this. If something that has worked in your life, then you would expect that it might work in the lives of others as well. So the same ancient principles, the greatest strengths of our cultural and spiritual heritage, Vivekananda's books make that same ancient truths easily accessible. He speaks in a language, in an idiom that we can understand, that we can relate to. Although Vivekananda is not too recent, he's now at least more than 100 years ago, quite more than at least 120 years ago. Now, normally, someone who is more than 100 years ago would seem to be outdated. The kind of times in which we live, even your phone, if it's just 5 years old, is already outdated. But you see that Vivekananda's greatness, the freshness, is such that even though he is more than 120 years ago he lived, if you read his books, you'll find that every word of it, every phrase of it, at least something from it, will speak to your heart. And it has the capacity to transform our lives. So that's something that I would strongly recommend. And I'll be happy to receive any comments or questions that you have for the next few minutes. So thank you.